Hey there, and welcome back to the Medical Minute. This week, we'll be comparing and contrasting ventilation perfusion scans and CT pulmonary angiograms. Ventilation perfusion scans and CT pulmonary angiograms are primarily used to test for pulmonary embolism, which is a blood clot in the lung or the pulmonary arteries leading from the heart into the lungs. The ventilation perfusion scan is a bit of a mouthful, so you'll likely hear it referred to as a VQ scan. It measures the circulation of air and blood within the lungs, which is why it's called a ventilation perfusion scan. If you're wondering why it's not called a VP scan, it's because Q is the letter used to describe blood flow in physiology. Similarly to a PET scan, a VQ scan creates images by detecting the presence of radioactive compounds that have been inhaled or injected into the body. A VQ scan does not create images by sending ionizing radiation through the body, like an X-ray or CT. The ventilation phase of the test starts with the patient inhaling an aerosol containing a radioactive compound. A gamma camera detects the radioactive gas as it flows through the lungs and allows the clinician to assess how well air is flowing or ventilating. The perfusion phase of the test creates images in a similar manner, but in this phase, the radioactive compound is intravenously injected. This allows for an image that shows blood flow or perfusion rather than ventilation. Since a pulmonary embolism affects blood flow, the perfusion phase of the scan is the major focus. Here is an example of the images created from a VQ scan. Image A is the ventilation phase. This is considered to be a normal image. Image B is the perfusion phase, and this image is abnormal. If the radioactive compound, or tracer, is building up in a region, we see a bright white area, known as a hotspot. In this case, the tracer is accumulating due to clots. The CT pulmonary angiogram, or CTPA, works similarly to the coronary angiogram we discussed in a prior medical minute. In this case, we're focusing on the pulmonary arteries instead of the coronary arteries. A bolus of iodine-containing contrast agent is intravenously injected, and images are taken as the contrast passes through the pulmonary arteries and throughout the lungs. Here's an example of an abnormal CTPA. This patient has a rare and particularly nasty PE called a saddle PE. With the two scans defined, let's talk about the advantages and disadvantages of each. Let's start off by pointing out that CTPAs provide much better images and are widely considered to be the most reliable tests for the diagnosis of a pulmonary embolism. Case closed, let's do away with the VQ scan, right? Not so fast. VQ scans involve much less radiation exposure than a CTPA. Let's take a pregnant woman that is suspected to have a PE. The reduced image quality is an acceptable cost for an imaging study that poses less of a risk to the fetus. This scenario is actually very realistic, as pregnant women are at an increased risk for blood clots. Radiation exposure isn't the only thing to take into consideration. The iodine-containing contrast used in a CTPA poses a risk to those with iodine allergies or renal insufficiency. VQ scans may be a suboptimal test for PE, but they provide a good plan B for patients who can't undergo a CTPA. Thanks for joining me this week. I hope that this video has helped you to better understand the medical decision-making involved in choosing these imaging studies. Join me next time for a review of IND procedures. And for more updates like these, come join us online